Let's start. So I am Bodhi. I'm Anne Kerbrat, as Olivier said. So I'm working with Olivier Komowicz and all the team in the Ampen Research Lab in Rennes. And I'm also work as a neurologist in the Rennes University Hospital, and I take care of MS patients every day. So in this presentation, I will really present you the neurologist and radiologist point of view and try to convince you that it's really important for us to have tools to help us to detect new lesions for MS patients in everyday clinical practice. So here is the summary of my presentation. So first, I will Sorry. So there are approximately 2 million people with MS worldwide. So it's a frequent disease. For example, in France, the prevalence of MS is about 1 per 1,000 inhabitants. The mean age at MS onset is around 60 years. It's important to note that it's a chronic disease, so that will evolve over decades. And when you start MS at 30 years, you will have MS for a very long time. The SEG ratio is about 3 women for 1 man. Then, what about MS pathophysiology? So it's a very complex disease. It's an immune disease. We don't know all about MS pathophysiology at the moment, but what we know is that there is an activation of the lymphocytes here that if in fact immune cells in peripheral blood, then these activated lymphocytes will cross the blood-brain barrier and come into the central nervous system. So for MS, the central nervous system is the brain, the brainstem, and also the spinal cord and the optic nerves. Then there will be a release of toxic molecule from these lymphocytes. They are called cytokines, and they will lead to demyelination. And when you can see this demyelination in anatomopathological study, like you can see here. And of course, and that's why it's so interesting to have MRI to monitor MS, you can still see these areas of demyelination on brain MRI, especially on T2 flare as hyperintensity, as you can see that. So in fact, you have to know that the pathophysiology of MS is far more complex than just the new T2 lesion of the MRI. And when we look at the T2 lesion on MRI, we only look at the acute inflammation in MS. But in fact, there is a more diffuse inflammation, as you can see there, with microglial activation, mitochondrial injury, and so on. And all that will lead to a degenerative part of the process that you can see when you just look at the brain T2 lesion on the MRI. Then what about the risk factors of MS? So it's a complex disease, and there is a part of genetics and also a part of environment to explain MS. For genetics, it's not just one gene that will explain MS, but in fact, a lot of gene. And there is many studies on the subject, and more than 200 genes that have an implication in MS have been identified to date. Now, for the environment, if you have an hypovitaminosis D, you will have an increased risk of having MS. And if you have MS and an hypovitaminosis D, you will have an increased risk of having relapse on new lesions on your MRI. It's the same for smoking. If you smoke, you will have an increased risk of having MS. And if you have MS and you smoke, you will have more active lesions on your MRI and more clinical relapse. There is also infection with EBV, Epstein-Barr virus, for example, will increase the risk of having MS. Now, what about MS phenotypes? Because in fact, we speak about MS, but there is different kind of disease. So the most frequent disease is the relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis, where you have, in fact, clinical relapse, like you can see here. A clinical relapse is a new neurological symptoms for a few days. For example, if you have an optic neuritis, you will have a visual loss, or if you have a myelitis, you will have a sensory symptom or motor impairment. That's what you can see here. Then you will have a recovery of the relapse, but sometimes, especially in older patients and with time and with disease duration, the recovery from relapse is incomplete and the patient will have disability. It is interesting to note on this slide that you don't have only clinical relapse, but you could also have some new lesions on MRI without clinical symptoms. And that's why having a follow-up with MRI is so important in clinical practice. And we don't just look at the clinical relapse of the patients. And in fact, we want to prevent this clinical relapse. Then, in about 50% of relapsing remitting patients, you will have an evolution to secondary progressive multiple sclerosis. So it's usually older patients. They start with this relapsing remitting phase, and then they have this secondary progressive multiple sclerosis phase with disability progression, as you can see there, but usually without relapse. And usually, they will have an increasing difficulty to walk, and they will increase their motor impairment. Then you have this other kind of multiple sclerosis called primary progressive multiple sclerosis. It's about 10% of the patients. So it's far less frequent than the relapsing remitting multiple sclerosis, where you don't have a relapse, or far less than in the relapsing remitting sclerosis. And from the beginning of the disease, you will have the disability progression without relapse. Usually, there is less lesions also on their MRI. Then what about MS and disability? So of course, when you think about MS, you will think about disability. And we have a score, a clinical score, when we think about disability and MS, in MS called the EDSS score. So for example, when you have an EDSS score of 3, you will have a difficulty to run. An EDSS score of 6, like there, you will require an assistant to walk. At 7, you will have to use a wheelchair. So in natural history studies, from natural history studies, we know that 50% of patients after 10 years of relapsing remitting MS will have a difficulty to run. And 50% of patients after 20 years of relapsing remitting MS will require an assistant to walk, for example. But it's quite old data, these natural history studies, and probably that we have changed the prognostic of the MS recently with the use of new treatments, and these treatments that will start early in the disease. I will explain that again later. So to date, we have about 15 drugs to treat MS patients. It's important to note that 20 years ago, there were in fact no treatment and no validated treatments to treat patients with MS. So there is a big change, and it's going on at that time. So there is many, many different treatments. Some are first line therapies, other second line or third line therapies. It is important to note that in MS treatment, usually when you have more efficacy, you also have more risk and more side effects. And it's also always a discussion with the patient to choose the right patient, the right treatment for the right patient and at the right time. And it's a balance between the risk and the benefits for the patients. So now, let's move to the main question of the talk. Why is it so important for us to detect new MS lesions on MRI scan? So the first important point is MS diagnosis. Why? Because there were an evolution of the diagnosis criteria over years. So a few decades ago, you have to wait for years to make the diagnosis of MS because you have to wait for relapse, the first relapse, the second relapse, you have to wait for disability to have the criteria to diagnose MS. But it has really changed with MRI, and because we can see these MS lesions, these T2 hyperintense MS lesions on MRI. And so now, with the last criteria in 2011, you can, in one day, in fact, you can make the diagnosis of MS. And it was also important to change this criteria because we have new treatment, and now we clearly know that we have to start this treatment early in order to prevent disability progression. So here are the current criteria that we use, and you can note on this criteria that we have to use In many, many, in fact, in all cases, we have to use the MRI to be sure that this is MS. And to have a diagnosis of MS, you need a dissemination in space of the symptoms, and you can have this dissemination in space with the clinical relapse. That is to say that the patient has two different neurological symptoms. So one time he has an optic neuritis, for example, and the second time it's a myelitis, and so you are sure that there is two different lesions, and you will have these two different lesions on MRI also. And you also need the dissemination in time, because MS is not a monofocal disease, but you have to prove that it will evolve over time, and that the patient will thus need a treatment to prevent these evolutions. Then it's a disease limited to the central nervous system, and you have to have no better explanation for the disease of the patients. So for the dissemination in space, when you use the MRI, you need to have at least one T2 lesion in at least two typical locations of MS. So this typical location has the periventricular location, as you can see there, the cortical or juxtacortical lesions. Here is the infratentorial lesions, and here are the spinal cord lesions. So at least one lesion in two different locations. So at that time, you can make the diagnosis of MS with only two lesions on the MRI. Then you have the dissemination in time, and to have this criteria, you need to have the presence of gadolinium enhanced or non-enhanced lesion on the same MRI, but it's not always the case. And then if you don't have that, you use a new T2 hyperintegrin lesion on a follow-up MRI scan. So that's why it's so important to have a good detection of the new lesions on the MRI to have an MS diagnosis. So usually when we don't have the dissemination in time on the first MRI scan, because the patient don't have some gadolinium enhancing lesions, we perform a follow-up MRI scan after 3 to 6 months and sometimes 6 months later to see if there is a new lesions, if there is an evolution, and if we need to treat the patients. Then what about the MS prognosis? So it's another important point. We know from large studies, including, for example, like this one, a very nice one, they have studied CIS patients. So CIS patients is the patient with the first events suggestive of MS. And there were a follow-up of 15 years in this study. And you can clearly show that there is a prognostic value of the new lesions on MRI in the first year of the disease and in the first year of the disease here. If you have a new lesion of in the spinal cord, a new lesion, a new infratentorial lesion, you will increase the risk to have disability 15 years later and the risk of having secondary progressive MS. So clearly, MRI has a very, very strong prognostic value, especially at the beginning of the disease. And the evolution of the MRI in the very first year of the disease in MS patients have a strong prognostic value. So we really need to compare this MRI and to be sure that there is no new lesions. And it will also help us to adapt the treatment. And it's the last point, and probably the more important one. It's important for treatment monitoring. So at that time, when you start a treatment, you want to your patient to have no evidence of disease activity. It's called NEDA, or sometimes moderate evidence of disease activity. So you want him to have no clinical relapse, no increase of this EDSS score, so the disability score as I explained before, and no new T2 lesion on the MRI. And something you can add the brain atrophy, but it's not done in clinical practice to date. So you clearly want to have no new lesion on MRI under treatment. And it's important to have no new lesions because there were studies that have clearly demonstrated that when you have new lesions under treatment, especially in the first year of the treatment, it will increase the risk of disability for the patient. For example, here in this study, 3 years later, if you have a new lesions, more than two T2 lesions on an MRI scan in the first years after the patient have started interferon beta, one of the treatment of multiple sclerosis, then you will have an higher probability to be disabled 3 years later. So with this kind of data, now we usually change the treatment if there is new lesions, and especially more than two or three lesions under treatment in order to prevent disability. And we will give to the patient an higher efficacy treatment. So with that, there is now a recommendation for the MRI follow-up of the patient. So I'll give you here an example. It's the French current recommendation, but there is almost the same in other countries, of course. So you have you need to have an MRI scan at the beginning of the treatment. Then you perform an MRI scan 6 months later with gadolinium injection to be sure that there is no new recent lesions under treatment, and then a yearly MRI scan. During this yearly MRI scan, you don't need to have gadolinium injection because you will do a comparison of the MRI and to detect new T2 lesions. So it's the subject of the day. And then if you have new T2 lesions on MRI scan, or if the patient have a clinical relapse, you will possibly change the treatment, and then you will do the same, another MRI scan 6 months later on yearly, and so on. So now at the moment, patients with MS clearly have very, very frequent MRI scan, and we need to compare this MRI scan to find the new lesion to be sure that the treatment is the right treatment at the moment for the patients. So here, as I tell you, was the observed recommendation, but you from the French recommendation, but you clearly have exactly or almost the same in all countries. So now what we do in clinical practice. So when I saw a patient in my consultation with MS at that time, I do the comparison between the two MRI scans, and I give you here an example. Here is the baseline T2 flare MRI scan of the patients. And here is another T2 flare MRI scan of the patient 1 year later. And I give you a few seconds, you have to find two new lesions. So as you can see, it's not really easy. It's clearly time consuming and error prone. And it is not really easy to find these two new lesions on an MRI scan, especially when there is a lot of lesions in the brain of the patients. So to illustrate and to give you an example, a few weeks ago, we make this experiment in our center, and we give 48 pairs of longitudinal T2 flare image to three different experts, one neuroradiologist, one neurologist, and one radiologist. And then they perform a consensual reading to have a ground truth. And clearly, when there is only one expert that look at the MRI, and with no automatic tools, of course, the sensitivity to detect new lesions on the MRI is quite low. And it takes a long time, around 5 minutes, to do the comparison. And in this experiment, we ask the expert not to take more time than they would have do in clinical practice to do their analysis. And we can clearly see that, for example, the expert one has found 90 lesions, and he has found 23 lesions that the expert two have not found, and 70 lesions that the expert three have not found, and so on. So it's clearly far from perfect when you do that without automatic tools to help us with this task. And it's important to keep in mind that it's important to find these new lesions, because you have the question of the treatment, and maybe if you don't detect a new lesions, you will keep the patients under a treatment, but he will have a clinical relapse a few months later, and things like that. So it clearly have clinical consequences. Then to conclude, I hope that I have convinced you that the detection of new T2 MS lesion on longitudinal T2 flare imaging is very important, both for MS diagnosis, MS prognosis, and treatment monitoring. But also, and I have don't speak about that in this presentation, but it's also probably important to better understand the disease by analyzing imaging data from large cohort of MS patients, and like this one that we have in France, but there is many other large cohort of MS patients. And usually we have clinical data, but it's less frequent to have large imaging data in this cohort, and maybe we have many things to learn with this systematic imaging data and automatic analysis of large cohorts of patients. And perspectives, of course, today we will talk about the brain lesions, but I, as explained before, the spinal cord lesions are also very frequent in MS patients and have a very strong prognostic value. So it's probably also something very important to have in clinical practice. And of course, when we look at the T2 flare lesions on brain MRI, We just look at it's imperfect. In fact, there is really different subtypes of lesions.